on the word Christ. We want to focus on the anointing. Because whenever we talk about the devil, we are not to glorify him. Whenever we talk about the devil, we are sure that he is defeated. Whenever we talk about the devil, we are talking about the victory of the cross. Amen. We are not in the habit of glorifying problems. We are not in the habit of glorifying problems. We are a people who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Our faith is the faith of victory, not the faith of defeat. Our faith is in the goodness of the Lord, both in the land of the living and in the world that is to come. Our faith is in what is good and not what is bad. Our faith is in what is right and not what is wrong. Our faith is in the overcoming victory of the blood of Jesus, of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, of the love of the Father. Amen. When I look at Colossians chapter 1 verse 27, if you can follow me please with the PowerPoint. Colossians 1 27. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, this scripture is very, very loaded. Loaded with the anointing. When you ask me, Pastor Dora, where can I find the anointing? The anointing is in the Word of God. The anointing is in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. The anointing is in the obedience of his people. Whenever you obey the Lord, the anointing comes upon you. To whom God would make known. Now I want you to know that your God is not the God of the unknown. He is not in the hide and seek business. God always wants to reveal himself to mankind. God always wants to reveal himself to the church. God would make known what is the riches of the glory. Now, just the word glory is already very, very powerful. But the Holy Spirit adds to the word glory the riches of the glory. The riches of the glory. The riches of the glory. Amen. That means it's over and above just being glorious. It's the riches, the abundance of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. In the natural, we are called the Gentiles. In the natural, we are not Jewish. But in the spirit, we are the spiritual Israel. But here, the Apostle Paul is talking about the Gentiles in the natural. So we are non-Jews. So when he talked about the Gentiles, he was talking about the non-Jews. Which is, what is the riches of the glory of this mystery? What is this mystery? This mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Why is that a mystery? Because you have to discover this for yourself. Now, I understand why a lot of times you find that your sons don't want to listen to you, or your daughters don't want to listen to you, or the youth don't want to listen to you. Why? Because everybody, you must do your own journey of discovery. Your life is your journey of discovery. I don't care how old you are. You are discovering yourself. You are discovering God. You are discovering the glory of God. You are discovering the power of God. You are discovering the goodness of the Lord. You are discovering the love of God. That's why we can't just chuck it through somebody's throat. Because it is a process of discovery. And this learning curve is a glorious one. Don't be worried when your children are going through their learning curve. Don't be concerned when the people around you are discovering God for themselves. It is a glorious journey. As long as you are praying for them, As long as you're covering them with your prayers, with your love, then the light and the glory of God will shine around them. And they will discover the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. It's the goodness of the Lord that brings people to repentance. Not your pressure, not your chastising, not your complaining, not your grumbling. Can we say amen? Jesus is the only Savior. Nobody can save you but Jesus. We can't save each other. We can't save our children. We can't save our spouse. No one can save you but the Lord Jesus Christ. Can we say amen? You need to experience him for yourself. You need to find him for yourself. The devil's weapons, they are the weapon of distraction. He gets you busy. He gets you distracted. So all the time you're going through the chores of life. You can be like Samson, you know, around the treadmill, going through all the chores of life and losing the essence. At the end of the day, always pause and meditate. What is my life like? Not just the activities. Not just the activities, but the quality of your life. I found an amazing app from the iTunes. This app enables me to just take a photo of a book or an article, and then it can translate that image, capture that image into text. And I can have the whole page downloaded to become a Word document, and I can edit it, I can add to it. It's a very, very convenient tool. And what's more, I found another app that can record my voice and translate it into any language that I want. The language that they've provided for me, and one of them is Chinese. So I can record my prayer, and they will translate it into Chinese. I'm talking about vocally. I will pray in English, and this lady, or you can choose a man, whatever you want, will speak my prayer in Chinese. Not only that, it will capture my voice into language, translated into the Chinese language. I was so amazed. We are living in the end times, church. And one of the end time signs is unity around the globe. Remember the Tower of Babel? God scattered them. And they were not able to communicate with one another. God scattered them. They ended up speaking different languages. They did not have one language. But now, we're going back. We're going back to the time when everybody will be able to communicate with one another. When the unity in the natural becomes easy. Technology is amazing, and you will see more and more and more. But I want to remind you one thing. Technology is heartless. There is no heart in technology. There's no heart in technology. What we think that we can do, what we think that we are so good at, I believe eventually will turn around and destroy us. Technology without God will end up to be a tool in the hand of the devil. The difference between you and a machine and an app is that you have a heart, and the heart is made for worship. The heart is made for the love of God to flow through. The love of God must flow through your heart to bless someone. The love of God must flow through your heart to bless someone. they will know that God is in our midst because of the love that we have for one another. Love which is not self-seeking. Love which is not self-seeking. Love which is not demanding. Love which is trusting and serving. Can we say amen? The word the anointing is the word Christos. It's also translated as the Messiah. The Messiah is the one who is anointed with holy oil. The Old Testament has a lot to say about the anointing oil, which is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. I want you to know that there's a lot happening in the world. We are living in the times when we are so flooded with technologies. We are so flooded with information. It's like everything is literally at your fingertip. There is a lot of Bible colleges going on the internet. There's a lot of Bible studies going on the internet. There's a lot of YouTube teaching going on the internet. But the key is discernment, clarity, understanding. There are so many, many voices fighting to lead you every day. But you need to discern. Is it the voice of your flesh? Is it the voice of the world? Or is it the voice of God? Discernment is particularly important now in this end time age that we are living in. And let me ask you, what is the key to discernment? The key to discernment is a pure heart. A pure, selfless heart. A heart that is not self-seeking. A heart that does not go after himself or herself. A heart that says, I'm following you all the days of my life. That's where the anointing is. In the Old Testament, the prophets, the kings, the priests, and the judges, they are called the anointed of the Lord. Why? Because they have to be separated unto their calling. They have to be separated for their service. Let me ask you this morning, do you have a heart to serve? And the question that is on top of that is, do you serve because of your self-interest? Or do you serve because of your love and devotion to the Lord? Loving God, the Word of God says that it's with all of your heart. All, not part of your heart. All, not part of your heart. With all of your heart, all of your mind. The mind must be renewed by the Word of God. Because the devil can talk to your mind. How many of you have heard the devil talking to your mind? Lift up your hands. It is very real. Devils talk. They talk and they try to make a way into your consciousness. So I have to serve the Lord with all of my heart, all of my mind, and all of my strength. Strength is needed for serving the Lord. We can't serve him just because it's convenient. We can't serve him just because it feels good. Sometimes you feel that it is not good. Sometimes you feel that you don't have the strength to serve. But those are the times and those are the places that the anointing will literally fall on you. That's why David said that God will prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And he said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. It is an exchange because it is a covenant. An exchange of devotion. An exchange of devotion. An exchange of devotion. Your devotion to God receiving his devotion to you. Why? Because all the channels will be unblocked and all the demons will be defeated. Amen. If I can ask you to look at 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13 with me. In my life as a pastor, I've seen a lot of people that got born again. But I'm very sad to say, I don't see a lot of people follow through. To be born again means that you have started, you've just started your journey. So you have to follow through. Don't just stay a convert. Mature. Grow up. Maturity is beautiful. And if you want the Lord to trust you with the anointing, to trust you with the burden removing, yoke destroying power, then you have to mature. Because God will not trust a child with his machine gun, because he may misfire. Maturity is beautiful. We're living in this time and generation when all our kids want to grow up fast. Have you noticed it? Have you noticed it? All our children, they can't wait to grow up. I'm talking about 2-year-old, 3-year-old. I'm talking about 5-year-old. They all want to grow up and grow up fast. And within society that we're living in, we're speeding them. We're speeding them up. With all that they are watching on television, with all the songs they are listening to, the growth has been accelerated. Nobody hardly knows what childhood is about. What childhood innocence, what being childlike is about. You must pray for your children. And don't be discouraged. Don't worry about them not liking you. If they don't like you, that means you're doing well. Amen. Amen. What did the Apostle Paul say? He said, if I still please men, I cannot be a servant of God. Amen. When I first got saved, my husband didn't like me. My sister-in-law didn't like me. My mother-in-law didn't like me. But now, they're all Christians, fervent for God. Amen. You must be willing to take a stand. We had our wedding service here yesterday, and I took the stand. I told them, I explained to them what marriage is all about. It's not about two people just liking each other and live together, and then when things don't go well, then bye. You know, there's a Chinese proverb that says that husband and wife is like your birds in the same bush. But when the storm comes, you better fly and leave one another, go separate ways. That's a Chinese proverb. How many of you have heard it? Do you want me to say it in Chinese? You know which one I'm talking about? Or you want me to say it in Chinese? 夫妻本是同林鸟, 大难来的时候各自飞. That's not right. That's pathetic. That's pathetic. Christians, we stay together. We go through the storms together. We soar together. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. For the power of unity, the power of faithfulness, a faithful man abounds in blessings. Amen. The wedding vow is till death do we part. It's not when we like it. We don't go separate ways. What God has joined, fused together, and he warns us, he said, let not man separate. Live with that devotion to God's word. Your devotion to God's word will be rewarded. Amen, and blessed. I want you to understand that serving God does not mean that every day of your life is sunshine and glory. Every Christian will be tested. You will be tested. We sang that song, was it last Sunday? Or Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy. Listen, tried and true. Trials will come to you. Tests will come to you. God is not stupid. He is not foolish. God has to be refined, has to be tested. How much more we, the sons and the daughters of God? It is not just say, you, Lord, Lord. It's not just lip service. It's the heart. It's the heart. It's the heart. All of us will go through times that we don't like it. All of us will go through times that you find it's too tough, it's too hard. That's the time when you know and you know that in and of yourselves, you are desperate. You are depleted. You need God. When you find that you can't love anymore, call on the Lord. I need you. When you find that you have no answers, call on the Lord. I need you. That's the exchange. Your inadequacy in exchange for His all sufficiency. We are being trained to do what? To call on the Lord. We are being trained to call on the Lord. We are being trained to call on the Lord. So embrace that process of learning. Don't put yourself down. Don't put everybody down. Don't put the people who annoy you. Don't put him down. Don't put her down. We are in the process of training to be trained to call upon the Lord. Can we say amen? And make a journal, make a diary, write down when you called upon him and when he came through for you. For every promise in Christ Jesus, every promise in the anointing, every promise in the salvation is yes and amen. Hallelujah. 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 There is a humbling process that every one of us has to go through. A humbling process. Be humbled. Willing to be humbled. Willing to express your bankruptcy. I'm bankrupt without God. My love bank is bankrupt. My hope is bankrupt. I need God. I need His refilling. I need His rejuvenation. Amen. As you humble yourself, you will be lifted up. Amen. It's not what I can do. It's not what I can do. It's what I can do through Christ, which strengthens me. Can we say amen? Thank you, Jesus. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13. The time of tribulations will be a very, very tough time. And we're moving towards that. We are living in the end times. We're living in the times of the beginning of sorrows. And you will find that your faith will be mocked. Your faith will be laughed at. The devil will mock you and laugh at you and say, all your prayers have come to nothing. The devil will seek to do his best to ruin your faith, to destroy your hope. The pressure will be so strong to quit, to backslide. Because the spirit of Antichrist is here, is working now. Please understand that the spirit has to be working for the system to service. The spirit has to be working for the man to rise up. First is the spiritual and then the natural. That's why don't get so busy with the natural and the natural and natural, and then you disregard the spiritual. Don't be so busy pleasing your children, doing everything for them, and have no time to pray for them. And then you only pray when they become like unmanageable. Always listen to me. First the spiritual and then the natural. Say to the person next to you, first the spiritual. than the natural. Amen. The same for healing, the same for prosperity, the same. Very, very important. First the spiritual, then the natural. The minute you find that you're striving with your husband or your wife, the minute you find that your children is they are hard to manage, or the minute you find that it seems like money is not coming, pray. Get into the spiritual. Declare the word of God. Rebuke the devil. Amen. Command all his obstacles and hindrances to go. Rebuild the spirit of Antichrist. Guard and protect your anointing. The grace of God upon your life. Because what makes it easy is the grace. Say to the person next to you, it's the grace of God. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13, look at this. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. If you look at Jesus, a powerful, powerful man when he was on earth, what did he say? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Love is the power of God. When you find that you can't love, you need the power. When you find that you can't function, you need the power. When you find that you don't have the wisdom, you need the power. When you find that you can't live a holy life, you need the power. It's grace and power. Grace and power. Grace and power. Can we say amen? Revelation chapter 5 verse 10. Revelation chapter 5 verse 10. And have made us, all of us, unto our God. What? Just children? Just ordinary men and women? No. Listen to this. Kings, priests, and we shall bring on the earth. Value is very, very important. That's what I preached yesterday. You must attach value to your marriage. If your marriage is not valuable to you, then you will trash it. But if your value is attached to marriage, then it becomes very precious to you. You must attach value to yourself. You must attach value to what you do, who you are, and what you do. You must see yourself with the value that God has given you. You must see others with the value that God has given them. Do you get this? The value that is imparted to us. God sees value in us before he made us. God saw value in me even before I was born. Well, you said that sounds very, very difficult. Well, let me ask you, how many of you have been pregnant? How many of you have had children? Lift up your hands. I mean, pregnant, referring to the ladies, have had children, referring to men. Did you make sure that your children would have value before you gave birth to them? No. No. When you were pregnant, when you have your children, you were convinced that your children already have intrinsic value. Isn't that right? That's why you rejoice when a baby is born. That's why you rejoice over your children, even before they prove themselves. Isn't that right? Why? Because love worketh by faith, and faith worketh by love. They are together. Without faith, there is no love. Without love, there is no faith. That's the way that we are made. That's why I asked you, do you believe in the good or do you believe in the bad? Challenge yourself. I know the majority of the times, the flesh would easily believe in the bad. That's why when problems come, we go down, we cry, we moan, we groan, we complain. But greater is He who is in you than he that is in the world. God's faith is faith in what is good. That's why He has planned for us the millennium. He has planned for us the new Jerusalem, the new heaven, and the new earth. Amen. How many of you believe that you're going to heaven? Lift up your hands. Amen. Hallelujah. Believe in heaven and see heaven on earth. Amen. Say to the person next to you, I'm living in heaven on earth. Amen. You have been made a king. That means you have been made a ruler. You have been made a priest. That means you have been made holy. You have been made to intercede. You have been made to come to God. A priest, a king, they are together. That's why in the world, eventually, it will be witchcraft. Witchcraft is very, very common now. Very, very common. You know, everything you've heard about, what's that called? The, what's that called? what's that called? I'm like Nebuchadnezzar. Tell me the dream. the witchcraft that's going on, the psychic, and also I'm looking for another word. We talked about that when we had the church camp. Huh? New Age, yes. New Age is also witchcraft. What else? We talked about that in when we had the church camp. What's that? It ends with chi. Anyway, it will come back. Praise the Lord. Amen. Remember how, you know, the rich people and eventually they ended up in that, the Freemasonry, and they ended up in that group, that occult. Illuminati, that's right. Illuminati. They call it Illuminati, but it's illuminated by whom? By Lucifer. Illuminated by Lucifer. That's what deception is about. Yes, there is light, but it's another kind of light. It's not the pure and the true light of the truth. Illuminati deals with the crooked. It deals with the perverted. It deals with witchcraft. It is still the operation of the realm of the spirit, because the realm of the spirit is over and above the realm of the natural. You will come under the realm of the spirit anyway, but you have to choose. Do you want to come under the realm of the occult, or do you want to come under the realm of truth, the Holy Spirit? Can we say amen? Amen. That's why, remember in the book of Joshua, he said, choose for yourself this day whom you want to believe. People choose what they want to believe. But as for me and my house, to believe is to serve the Lord. You will serve whom you believe in. You believe in money, you will serve money. You believe in the occult, you will serve the occult. You believe in the truth, you will serve the truth. You believe in holiness, you will serve holiness. You believe in selfishness, you will serve yourself. Faith and service are together. Together. Know this. We are called to ring. I know I've said this many, many times. The first person that you need to ring over, in fact, the only person that you can ring over, it's not somebody else. It's whom? Yourself. You must rule and ring over yourself. You must speak to your ugly emotions. How many of us have ever felt ugly towards someone? Lift up your hands. Now, if you don't lift up your hands, I'm going to call you out and cast out the devils from you. Every one of us, we have felt ugly. But is that from God? Is that from your born-again spirit? No. Where's that from? From the devil. From your flesh. Because the flesh is self-seeking. So what do you need to do? Rebuke it. Don't struggle with it. If there's anything ugly in your life, anything that is bad, that is ugly in your life, separate it from yourself. Separate the sin from the sinner. Separate what is ugly from yourself and look at it right in the eyes and rebuke it. We must pray for ourselves. How many of you pray for yourself? Lift up your hands. It's very, very important. You must pray for yourself. In fact, more than praying for anybody else. Amen. You must pray for yourself. And then your relationship with others will be easy. You will not be so condescending. You will not be so prideful. You will not be struggling. Because it is written, if you cannot love someone whom you can see, don't tell me that you are loving me, that is the Lord saying, whom you cannot see. God is very practical. He's saying that if you can't love someone whom you can see, don't lie to me and don't deceive yourself and think that you are loving me. So our relationship with people is very, very important. Amen. And love is a decision. Love is a choice. Love has its tough times and difficult times. But as you persevere, as you devote yourself to the love walk, every devil will have to leave you. Can we say amen? That's power. That's the anointing that comes out of that devotion and dedication. That's why you notice in the Old Testament, they did not have the Holy Spirit. They haven't got the Holy Spirit coming on the inside of them. They've only had the Holy Spirit coming upon them. But what made them so powerful, if you could remember, Elijah, so powerful. Remember Samuel, so powerful. What made them so powerful? The devotion. The dedication, the commitment. We call it the calling. Can we say amen? Thank you, Jesus. So what makes you so special is your anointing. Christians, we are the anointed ones of God. The minute you become born again, you become a Christian. The word Christ is the word Christos, meaning the anointed. It means the anointing. So the minute you got born again, you come into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. You come into the anointing. You become anointed. You become covered. You become graced. The key is stay anointed. Say with me, stay anointed. Anointed. Amen. Stay anointed. Stay anointed. Stay in the grace. Stay in the anointing. Don't try to squeeze yourself to get something. Don't try to squeeze someone else to get something. It's by grace. Come through the grace. Come through grace. Come through the anointing. Amen. If you look at 1 John 2:27. What makes us special, remember, is the anointing. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. Stay. Stay in the anointing. Stay anointed. Stay faithful to the word. Stay faithful to your church. Stay faithful to your calling. Amen. The anointing which you have received of him abides in you, and you need not any man to teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you of all things, and its truth, and its no lie, and even as it hath taught you, you shall abide in him. Jesus is the vine, we are the branches. We are made to be faithful. No one enjoys having many husbands. No one enjoys having many wives. Why? Because you are made to be faithful. No one enjoys going around and just like a butterfly. We enjoy even after your holidays to come home. Have you ever heard of this saying? Nowhere like home. We love our home. Why? Because we are made to abide. We are made to have roots. We are made to be rooted and grounded. A tree cannot yield any fruit if you keep plucking it out and planting it somewhere, and then pluck it out and plant it somewhere. Isn't that right? We are made to be rooted and grounded and bear fruit, fruit that blesses many. Can we say amen? Amen. So love, value faithfulness, and practice faithfulness. Amen. We're talking about the anointing. We're talking about having the anointing to function in the end times. Now, somebody thinks that having the Holy Spirit, having the anointing means like I'm airy-fairy, you know. The Lord leads me, the Lord tells me this, the Lord tells me that. I want you to understand that there is a difference between fanaticism and truth. I have witnessed, I have seen many fanatical Christians. I mean, they were so fanatical, I would call them crazy. Fruits and nuts. It's like the Cadbury chocolate. And chocolate is bad for you. There's a big difference between fanaticism and faith in God. Fanaticism is like all over the place. You don't have a life. Your life has no testimony. God is calling you everywhere, and nowhere is bearing fruit. You are never faithful. You don't like people, but you want to preach. You don't love people, but you want to serve. And you are withdrawn. Why? Because you can't get along with people. I love the Lord, but I hate people. You come to church. You just want to show off your spirituality. We've had people that come, and we hardly know them. And they came, and they just bowed down and cried and cried and cried all through our praise and worship, disturbing everybody. I won't call that spirituality. That's not spirituality. That is fanaticism. We have had people coming, laying hand and prophesying. And at the end of the prophecy, one of our sisters ended up crying and crying and crying because she was believing God for a boy or for a girl. But they prophesied over her that she's going to have a boy. And I said, whom do you believe, the Lord or this prophet, this wacky one? Very, very important. Make sure that you don't follow people no matter whom they call themselves. They may call themselves the apostle. They may call themselves the greatest prophet. You always follow the word of God. The word of God. Prophecy can only confirm what God has been telling you. Amen. I've had people prophesying over me, saying that I should go to China and minister to the students. I said, forget it. I'm not going. Why? Because the Lord has not told me. It's very, very important. Well, you said, what if what they said is true and you've missed God? No. I know and I know and I know and I know that what they've said is not true. If you are not sure of God and you need somebody to come and tell you what to do, you better mature. Can we say amen? The devil can easily send you someone. He's called the deceiver. He can deceive. That's why the Bible says that even the very elect will be deceived in the end times. Even the very elect will be deceived. Why? Because there is no truth in them. You must not just listen and listen and listen. You must have God in you, the truth in you, your calling in you, your security in you, your confidence in you. Why? Because Christ is in you, the hope of glory. Can we say amen? Amen. It is written in the Bible that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. We're living in the end times. Your walk with God will definitely be shaken. Now, those of us that have been in a leadership for a long time, I mean, we have seen this. We have seen people coming to church and on fire and loving God and serving God. At the same time, we see them being shaken. I mean, there's a time that they'll be on fire, loving God, serving God. And then right after that, we see a time of shaking. And then we see those that have come through the shaking. There is that stability. There is that faithfulness. There is that maturity. I believe that's what every Christian will go through. How many of you have gone through a time of shaking? Lift up your hands. And you know. Yes. Yes. If you haven't been shaken, I don't know where you have been. Amen. It's very, very important that we go through the fire. We go through the refining process. We go through the shaking process. Because let me ask you, when were the three Hebrew children promoted? In the book of Daniel. When were they promoted? After they had gone through the fire, in the fiery furnace. When was Daniel promoted? Daniel, you have to understand, he served different dynasties, different kings. When was he promoted? When he was thrown into the lion's den. So Christians, can I ask you, don't be afraid of tough times. Don't be afraid of hard times. Don't run from them. Don't run from the devil, but defeat him. Can we say amen? Hallelujah. Trample on him. Tread on him. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. You have been called more than a conqueror, more than an overcomer. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Don't run from the battles of your life. Run to the devil. Run to Goliath and defeat him in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory be to God. Husband and wife, you need to stand up and say, devil, you can't have my marriage. Parents, you need to stand up and say, devil, you can't have my children. And mean it, and mean it, and mean it. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Christians, we must live with guts on the inside. Not hollow, not just lip service. Can we say amen? Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken from off your shoulder, the devil's burden, and his yoke from off your neck. The devil cannot sit on your shoulder, cannot yoke your neck to him anymore. You are not allowing him to turn your head and make his decisions. Amen. Don't let him hook your neck to him, and whatever God says to you, you say, no, 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 no. Amen. It is written, the burden shall be removed from your shoulder and his yoke from off your neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Our God is the miracle working God. Nothing is impossible with God, and nothing is impossible to those that believe. Believe in what? Not the problem. Believe in the good. Believe in the good of every person. Believe in God's miracles. Believe in God's provision. Believing in the truth. Believe in the promises of God. Amen. Amen. You don't need someone to complete you. Husband and wife, you don't need your wife to complete you. You don't need your husband to complete you. Because I went through the same problem myself. When Sonny was away, I kept blaming him. I blamed him for how I felt. I felt I was not sufficient. But the Lord corrected me. God created every one of us sufficient. God created everyone sufficient in his sufficiency. In Chinese, we have this saying called 小女人, you know? In English, strict translation would be a little woman. It's like, husband, do everything for me, please. I can't do anything, I'm just a woman. I can't go anywhere because I'm just a woman. That's called a little woman, 小女人, you know? Always trying to hide behind your husband. No, you are not called to hide behind your husband. You can be a prayer warrior. Praise God, hallelujah. You can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. Amen. Not in the competitive sense. We are not to compete with one another. And the same way for singles. You don't need anyone to complete you. You can shine for Jesus just as you are. Glory be to God. Amen. And if your husband has passed away, don't think that you are now living always in lack. No, you're not. Your sufficiency is not in someone else. Your sufficiency is not in someone else. Your sufficiency is in, can you tell me? Christ. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And that's what makes you strong, glorious, victorious. Amen. I'm blessed. I'm married already, but I don't mind. I mean, even if I were single, I would still shine for Jesus. Only one amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Whether you're married, whether you're single, shine for Jesus. Amen. Be proud of who you are in Christ Jesus. Live your best unto the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Can we say amen? All the single women say amen. Amen. You are not a second-class citizen. You are not nobody. Glory be to God. You don't need a man to complete you. And all the single men say amen. You don't need a woman to complete you. Your sufficiency is in Christ Jesus. Amen. So demolish that lie. Pull down that stronghold in the name of Jesus. Can we say amen? Hallelujah. Very, very important that we give the devil no foothold. Once again, the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Who is your first love? Louder. Who is your first love? Who is your first love? Not your girlfriend. Not your boyfriend. Not your husband. Not your wife, because you must be loved to love. You must receive the first love that comes from Jesus for you. Then the love will come out of you to love. We have to understand this and teach our children. Otherwise, our children will be jumping and searching everywhere. I need someone to love. I need someone to love me. I mean, isn't this all those songs are about? You listen to all the songs in the media, it's all the songs are about loving someone and someone loving me, right? And some songs are so silly, they talk about loving food, loving clothes. But the love of God will lift you up and promote you and glorify you. Can we say amen? Lift up your hands now, amen, to be glorified, to be promoted, to be sanctified. Amen. Go with me to 1 John 2:18. I want to spend some time on the spirit of Antichrist. How many of you understand the prefix anti? What does that mean? Come on. Against. Christ, the anointing, the anointed. So that means the spirit that comes against the anointing. The spirit that comes against the anointed. So if you look at 1 John 2:18, little children, it is the last time, as you have heard, that Antichrist shall come. Even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. So what is the Antichrist spirit? It is the spirit that attacks the anointing on your life. The spirit that attacks the anointing on your life. The spirit that distracts you, The spirit that causes you to be natural, the spirit that causes you to be frustrated, the spirit that causes you to focus on yourself, the spirit that causes you to be discouraged and downtrodden. Because when your heart is burdensome, when your heart is distracted, then what happened? The anointing will drain. That's why Jesus said, guard your heart. Because your heart is the container. Your heart is the container. Your heart is the container. Your heart must stay anointed. Your heart must stay anointed. Value the anointing. Protect your anointing. Don't let anyone or anybody, any situation, take away your anointing. Can I ask you to lift up your hands and say, Lord, I protect the anointing that you have given me. No man, no situations can take away this anointing, which is so precious, that you have given me. Amen. It's the anointing that will lift you up. It's the anointing that separates you. It's the anointing that makes you a man of truth and a man of honor. It's the anointing that attracts your heart to prayer. It's the anointing that attracts your heart to the Word of God. It's the anointing that imparts power into your life. I want to hide like this, and then I'll follow the Lord. Now, if you look at 1 John 4:3, this is a very, very important teaching. Every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof you have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. Now, what is the Holy Spirit telling us? Every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. The spirit that puts Jesus Christ in a category all by himself, that frames the Bible and put it up, nobody can read it. Nobody is good enough to read it. The Holy Spirit is too precious for you. You won't get any share of the Holy Spirit until you're good enough. Healing is not what God can easily give you. You have to earn for it. You have to pray hard for it. Any spirit that tells you that Jesus will not grace you, any spirit that tells you the anointing will not work for you, will not work in the natural for you, the anointing only is for the spirit, it will stay spiritual, that kind of teaching, that kind of thought is of the devil. Do you get it? The spirit that tells you are not good enough, the spirit that tells you can't do this, the spirit that tells you no, you won't get your healing. Your marriage won't be healed. You won't be restored. You can't get that. You can't get that. The spirit that tells you that the anointing won't work in the flesh of a man, won't work in the natural, that is the spirit of Antichrist. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. You can sing very well, but you can't live very well. You can worship and praise, but you can't live. That is the spirit of Antichrist. I want you to understand that the anointing is very, very practical. The anointing has to be part of your life. The anointing is part of your life. The anointing has to be lived out. You lived out in him. You live and move and have your being. When you're having your exam, the anointing will work for you. When you're going to the doctor, the anointing will work for you. When you're going shopping, the anointing will work for you. When you're having a problem, the anointing will work for you. Because he's Emmanuel, God who is without, who is with us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. Do you get this, church? His yoke is easy. His burden is light. Amen. Amen. Do not allow the devil to attack you, because when he attacks you, he's attacking your anointing. And once the anointing is lifted, once you don't have the anointing like Samson, you have no power, you have no grace, you have no spirituality. The Bible will be boring to you. The service will be too long for you. Prayers will be too tough for you. That's very, very sad and very, very bad. Lift up your hands and say, Lord, I treasure your anointing over and above anything else in my life. Amen. In fact, it is so important that John mentioned it again. Who wrote the book of Revelation? John. He mentioned it again in 2 John chapter 1, verse 7. John, 2 John 1, 7. For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Amen. Can I ask you to lift up your hands and say with me, I believe. I am anointed. I believe. I am called. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let me finish with this, Revelation chapter 13, verse 18. The Apostle Paul, he said, you have to stop being a man. Stop being a natural person. Why? Let's look at Revelation chapter 13, verse 18. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast. For it is the number, read with me, number of a man. And his number is 666. That means 666. Six is the number of a man. Humanism will always lead to the reign of the devil. Your human side will always cave in to doubt, to weakness, to unbelief, to anger, to frustration, to rebellion. That's why you must not look at your human side. The self-will, the self-pride will always cause you to cave in to pressure, to problems, to difficulties. We must stand not with our human side, but stand with the anointing. Amen. Christ is in you the hope of glory. The Apostle Paul, he said, it's by the grace of God that I am what I am. So when I look at you, I'm not supposed to see you. I'm supposed to see the grace of God. When I look at you, I'm not supposed to see you. I'm supposed to see the anointing. I'm supposed to see the new creature in Christ Jesus, the born again kenosis, the new creation, full of glory, full of faith, full of hope, more than a conqueror, a winner all the time. When you look at me, you're not supposed to see me. You're supposed to see the anointing, the grace, the Christ in me. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Amen. I want to give you the last picture. I want you to contrast two pictures with me. Revelation chapter 19, verse 19 to 20. There are going to be two armies formed in the last times, in the end times. Revelation chapter 19, verse 19 to 20. And I saw the beast And the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. There is going to be an army that will be gathered to the Antichrist. There's going to be an army that would ride together with the devil, with Lucifer himself, with the beast marked with 666. And they would come against the anointed. They would come against the anointing. They would come against the love of God, the calling of God. I am not of that army. Can we say amen? Amen? There's nothing in common between him and the church. We belong to another army. I know whose side I am on. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 14. My flesh does not listen to his voice. My mind does not listen to him. My will does not do his will. Can we say amen? We know which side we are on. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 14. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. If you are in that army, lift up your hands. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to obey the word of God. I'm going to call those that want to be consecrated, dedicated, devoted, committed to God to come forward. And I'm going to anoint you with oil. I'm going to anoint your forehead to mark you for God's use, God's calling, God's protection, and God's consecration. And if I can have somebody to help me to call the Sunday school teachers to come down as well, and amen. And I'm going to say that to all of them, because we are living in the end times. It's very, very important that you know that you are separated, that you are called, and you are anointed. Called, separated, and anointed. That's what protects you. That's what glorifies you. Your consecration, your devotion, your commitment. Remember our New Year's Eve service, the prophecy that we got. 2015 is the year of divine flow. That means we must flow with him. The river of Ezekiel must not be just be ankle deep, nor knee deep, nor loin deep. You must be in the flow of the Holy Ghost. And to be in the flow of the Holy Spirit, you must be consecrated, devoted, and dedicated. Like Jesus, not my will, but your will.